Welcome. In this guitar fretboard lesson, I'm going to teach you how to find notes on a guitar. By the end of this lesson, you'll be able to find and identify any notes on the guitar fretboard easily. And this is not just about finding guitar notes for beginners. People who have played guitar for years and years sometimes still don't know how to find notes on a guitar fretboard. To really learn all the notes on a guitar, it's actually not about using a fretboard notes chart or a guitar fretboard diagram. And it's not even about fretboard memorization. It's about learning the logic of the fretboard on a guitar. So if you used a fretboard notes diagram and tried to just brute force memorize the notes on a guitar, you wouldn't necessarily see that logic, which is what I'm going to show you right now. I'm Jared from Sound Guitar Lessons, teaching you how music works on the guitar. I've been teaching private lessons since 2004, and on this channel, I'm taking all my best exercises and topics and effective practice strategies and bringing them to you here. So if you're new, please subscribe. From this video, we're going to get you to be able to find and identify any note names on the guitar fretboard. In order to do that, here's what we're going to go over. We're going to go over the open guitar string notes. We're going to talk about the structure of natural notes, like the white keys on a piano, but where they are on the guitar. We're going to find those natural notes on the sixth string. We're going to find those natural notes on the fifth string. It's all going to be pretty straightforward and pretty easy. We're going to talk about finding the in-between notes, the sharps and flats, and identifying those. And once we know that stuff, then there's a simple trick we can use to find any other note on the guitar, referencing that initial information. After that, I'll talk about how to practice it so you can really get it down. And make sure you stick around to the end, because at the end, I'm going to mention when I think it's actually useful to be identifying note names on the fretboard, because it's actually not something we need to always know with everything we're playing. There's kind of certain places where knowing the actual note names is really helpful, and beyond that, it can actually be a little bit weighing us down. So I'll talk about that at the end. Okay, let's quickly go over what the open guitar string notes are. You probably already know this. If not, this will be great. If you kind of know it, I have an acronym for you that's going to firm that up, and you'll never forget after this. It is E, A, D, G, B, E. This low string, the thickest string, that's our low string. This thinnest string, that's our high string. This thickest string, this is our sixth string. The high string, the thinnest string, is our first string. So 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The acronym that is my favorite, and there's plenty out there, is elephants and donkeys grow big ears. If you memorize that sentence, you will never forget the open string names again. And we need to memorize this. There's a couple things we need to memorize, and then we use this small pool of knowledge of things that we have as just memorization to then use as a resource and find anything else on the fretboard. So this is one of those things we really do have to know, these open string names. So using the acronym should help a lot if you don't just have them down already. Okay, now we need to go over the structure of the natural notes. So these are the same notes as the white keys on a keyboard or piano, and they're the same notes as the C major scale, though it's not necessarily that we're thinking in C, so we don't need to say it's the C major scale, but it's all the natural notes, no sharps, no flats, all the natural notes, the white keys. What we need to identify here with the natural notes is just where there are notes that are a half step apart, and that's it, because everything else, once we identify that, is a whole step apart. So there are two places where, with the natural notes, and all of them are A, B, C, D, E, F, and G, so those are the letters, there are two places where they're a half step apart. So one fret, our smallest interval distance, one fret apart. And that is between B and C and E and F. Now, this is another one of those pieces of information that we need to have memorized. We need to really know this. But just kind of trying to remember it is really hard. So I want to give you a way that I like to use to remember it. Once we know the open strings and we know that this is E, A, D, G, B, E, and you can use your elephants and donkeys grow big ears if that helps. B and E are the top two strings, these highest two strings, string one, string two, E and B. On those two strings, if you just play the open string and then the first fret, open first, string two, open first, that can serve as a reminder for where those half steps are. This is E and this is F, and those are a half step apart. And this is B and this is C, and those are a half step apart, and those are the only places where natural notes are a half step apart, okay? Every other natural note, every other consecutive pair of natural notes are whole steps apart, okay? So A to B is gonna be a whole step apart. G to A is gonna be a whole step apart. F to G is gonna be a whole step apart. If it's E to F, or B to C. So it's just nice to, like, instead of just, oh, I hope I remember which one it is, you can think on the guitar, and then that helps reinforce the actual note names of the open strings as well. So I found that is really useful for a lot of people, even if we've been playing guitar for a long time. So we got that down. Our structure of our natural notes are, we have A, B, C, D, E, F, and G, and E and F, like these two notes, and B and C, like these two notes, are a half step apart, okay? You're gonna see how important that is to know as we do this. All right, now that we have that information, we're ready to find the natural notes on the sixth string. Finding the natural notes on the sixth string and the fifth string are gonna be another foundational element to this that we really need to be able to find everything else. So it's gonna be pretty straightforward. If we can remember, well, our starting string, so we need to know that this is open E and this is open A, okay? String six and string five. And then we just need to remember when to go a half step and when to go a whole step. We're just trying to play natural notes. So we got E, and then E to F is one of those spots. So F is a half step, just one fret up, okay? Is F to G a half step? Nope, whole step. Is G to A a half step? Nope, whole step. A to B, go whole step. Okay, we're on B. We need to remember B to C is a half step. This will take some time to get used to when to do those half steps and when not to, but you have the information to work on it. So definitely just up and down this string to work on this for a while will do the trick. In standard tuning, once you know those, they will never change. This will always be B, this will always be A, this will always be C. So that's gonna come up over and over again and be super handy, again, unless you change tuning. So C to D, whole step. D to E, whole step. E to F, we're half step again. So you can go up a little higher if you have room on your guitar. F to G, whole step. G to A, whole step. And always go back down. Don't just go one direction. F to E, that's a half step. And you'll start seeing these in these spots too, which is gonna be helpful, but definitely hands-on practice this. D to C, okay, whole step. C to B, there's our half step. B to A to G, whole step. G to F, take your time. F to E, go nice and slow. Do it a bunch of times. I want you to be able to go up and down naming the notes. That way, with that red flag going off when you hit the B to C, when you hit the E to F, knowing that that's a half step and just straight up everything else is a whole step, two fret distance, okay? So that is that for the sixth string, and we're simply gonna do the exact same thing for the fifth string. So once you know what starting note you have, it's the same logic otherwise. So we have A, this is the fifth string, we have A to B, whole step. Now we're on B, so B to C, half step, C to D, whole step, D to E, whole step. And if you've never thought of what notes, I mean, anybody, if you've never played guitar before, minus how awkward it is to start to just fret notes and get notes to ring, we can all do this. So E to F, half step, and at the same time, anyone playing for many years could benefit from this too, because a lot of us play without ever going back and really kind of working from the ground up and mapping these things out. So here we are, F to G, G to A is a whole step, A to B is a whole step, B to C, half step. You can hear that half step there. Bum, bum. Okay, C down to B, half step, B to A, whole step, A to G, whole step, G to F. And of course you will get used to these as you do this more. I can look at the guitar and even just see, oh, I'm gonna go down to E, but or you can think backwards with the alphabet, which is really hard, but I really want you to do that. Don't skip that because it's like weird to think backwards. Definitely do it because of that and take it nice and slow. F to E is a half step. That's one of our half steps. E to D, whole step. D to C, whole step. C to B, whole step. B to A, I'm sorry, C to B. I played it right, said it wrong. C to B is our half step, of course, and B to A is our whole step. I'm kind of just skating over that quickly because it should make sense what I'm talking about. I don't need to elaborate much more on it. You just need to make sure you can go up and down on that. Each string, sixth string and fifth string. Of course, you can do it on other strings, but you'll see how you need these two, and we're gonna use those to find everything else, okay? Okay, of course, now we just need to address what those in-between notes are, and that's what sharps and flats are. So if a note is below a natural note, and there's room for a accidental note, a note with a sharp or a flat that's not a natural note, then it's flat if it's below. Okay, so if I go to E, F, G, A, okay, if I go to A, and then I go to the note that's between G and A, I can call that A flat. And these are weird because it can also be G sharp. This note being G, the note above it is G sharp, the same note. This is called inharmonic equivalent. Okay, A flat and G sharp are the same pitch. If you're having a hard time remembering what, is it sharp or is it flat? Think of flat as a flat tire going down. So flat is the down way, A to A flat, it's below. Okay, and think of sharp as a sharp pencil pointing upward, okay? Or something sharp, pointy spikes pointing up. So G, G sharp, okay? As far as when to call one sharp or flat, in music, it's totally based on tonal context. So it could be A flat in a certain situation in music, and it could be G sharp in a certain situation in music based on the key and various factors. So for now, just use whatever. If you are going to go up and kind of count everything, just go ahead and sharp things on the way up. So you go E, F, F sharp, G, G sharp, A, A sharp, B. You don't have to actually practice that way, but if you are going to try to do all of them, do sharp on the way up and then flat on the way down. E, E flat, D, D flat, C, B, B flat, A. Okay, as far as what I think you should really practice is just make sure you can get those natural notes and then know really clearly how to turn it flat or sharp. So if you get on B, cool, you can find B flat, right? So if I ask you at this point with that information to find any note on the fifth or sixth string, we should be able to do it, right? If I say find A flat on the fifth string, okay, well, this is A, you could count all the way up, or you can use what I call a checkpoint. There's a few checkpoints we can use sometimes, and that's just the 12th fret is the same note as the open string. So okay, go to A, make it flat, you know, take your time, find it however you want to find it. So we should be able to find any note on those two strings. Now, one of the other checkpoints is the fifth fret, because if we're used to tuning like this, where you play the fifth fret and then you play the next open string, play the fifth fret, it kind of is a giveaway. If you know your open strings and you can do that fifth fret thing, then it gives you like, oh, this is D because I use that to tune against my open D string, or this is A because I use that to tune against my open A string. So that could be helpful as well, but definitely the open strings, and then all those open string names are the same names as your double dotted fret if you have dots or inlays on your guitar, and which is the 12th fret. Okay, here is the real meat of it. Here is the real lesson. I had to set everything up with all of that, right? If you knew a lot of that, you're just kind of waiting for the real trick here. The real secret, the real answer, and the exercise is about now how we find other things on the guitar once we have that information. And the logic of the guitar that I was talking about has to do with seeing the fretboard with interval shapes, with interval distances, not even note names, but just this approach of looking at the fretboard to say, oh, if this note is something, then this other note, this physical distance away, is always going to be something else. So for example, interval of a fifth or something, like if this is one in a scale, in a chord, in whatever, then this is always going to be five along this whole string, and actually on several other strings, almost all the strings except for one. So 1 5 1 5 1 5 1 5 1 5 1 5 1 5. So that is different than other instruments, including the piano or anything that is not this fretboard layout, right? So this movable shape knowledge is really important. And what we're going to use here is just the octave shape. It is the thing that unlocks and everything else. And you can start to find in the future chord tones, scale degrees, you know, analyzing melodies, whatever you want. This first step is going to open up the door to going that direction with things. So the octave shape, we need to learn the octave physical shape off of every string. I'll do it on the fifth fret here. This note is E, F, G, A, okay? But more importantly, I just want to show you the physical shape that we want to do is two frets over, two strings up. Two frets up, two strings up, okay? So the octave of this note is here, okay? That physical shape is really important because if I play this note, then I can see that's the same note. It's already happening. We don't need to learn and try to memorize and try to drill the notes on the D string if you can quickly see, oh, I know how to find my A on the sixth string, and then there it is on the fourth string. So A, A, okay? So that octave shape, so that's gonna be the case for how we find things on the fourth string. Okay, so if I wanted to find B flat on the fourth string and I can quickly find a B flat on the fifth string, on the sixth string, then I just go up an octave. And you don't have to count up and then go to it like that once you do this a bunch, and you will just end up memorizing where B flat is here, but you'll see it really quickly, just in your mind even. Because I know B flat's there, it's just there, it's just instant. It still is instant, but you're seeing it as a context of a relationship to this other B flat, to this lower B flat. So, same shape off the fifth string. So any note we wanna find off the third string is gonna be that same octave shape. This note is, if we counted it up, did it what we did, A, B, B to C, half step, C to D, whole step, it's D, or same as the open D, then that octave shape is the same thing. Two frets up, two strings up, okay? So, okay, some players play with octaves as a texture. Wes Montgomery, the guitar player, was really famous for that and using his thumb like that. So, this is D. Okay, well, we found D up there too. Okay, so we see that octave shape, and again, it will eventually be instant. And it's okay if you have to count up to it and then go find it and say, oh, it looks like it's D. That's fine, and then test it out or to listen for it or whatever. But it will eventually just be, because you can find this in your mind, just kind of spot it on the fifth string, you'll just see that that's D. So I can already see where other things are around this without having to count it out or map it out or whatever, just because I'm seeing in that same way with the relationship with the distances, with more octave shapes and stuff like that. So that physical octave shape is off the sixth string and off the fifth string. Now, off the fourth string and the third string, it changes. So the octave shape is gonna be three frets up and two strings up once we get to the fourth string. Okay, so if I'm playing this note here, I'm playing fifth fret, fourth string. We didn't map out our fourth string, but we figured out that we can find it from the sixth string. So this is cool too. You're playing a note up here and you need to think, well, what note is it? Well, you got to think the octave shape down here, downward. Okay, what's the octave shape down? Oh, and then count it up off the sixth string or whatever you need to do. And that's G. So, oh, this note is G. So, well, here's our other octave shape. Oh, that note is G. So we're actually leveraging this big distance on the fretboard, this big two octaves, to say, if we know that's G, then we know that's G, and we know that's G. Or if you're coming down, if you're playing this note and you're like, what is this note? Geez, I don't know, what am I playing? Octave shape down, what is that? That's what all three of them are, okay? So we just found this, oh, octave shape off of the fourth string is three frets up, two strings up, same shape off the third string. Okay, what note is this? Let's find out. Well, I'm gonna go an octave shape down. I'm playing fifth fret, third string. Let's go octave shape down. Okay, now I'm playing third fret, fifth string, and we did find all our notes off the fifth string. We can be quick at seeing those. It's not like you can't count up. You know this is open G. Of course you can count up with that logic. But if you start to memorize and have a quicker sense of what the note names are on the fifth and sixth string, this is actually more beneficial because then you're seeing this web of connectivity on the fretboard instead of just this in a vacuum, every note, let me count up and find it. So, okay, I figured out that that's C, and so therefore that is C. Now the octave shape off the third string is that wider one again, three frets up and two strings up, and so that note is C. Now actually the top string is quite easy because it's just gonna be the exact same fret as whatever the sixth string is, because these are both E notes, these are both the same note. So the top string, actually, you'll end up finding that way. If you play this note here, you're like, what is that? Well, think of what note this is, okay? So we're really getting used to thinking off the fifth and sixth string and then branching everything else off of that. So that's it, that's how we do it. That's the octave shape helping us, the two octave shapes, because of the tuning of the guitar, that's why there's two octave shapes, but helping us find anything. So of course, we wanna actually drill this and practice this to get it down. And then once you practice it a bit, it'll come into play in real life when you're just playing something and you want to find the note, and then you have a tactic, you have a method to go about doing it. So one way to practice, I'm going to give you two ways. One way to practice it is to play a random note and then find what it is, okay? So then you would go octave, octave, and then think of what that is, and you'll get quicker and quicker and quicker and quicker at just saying, oh, that's B flat actually, because I was playing that earlier or whatever. And of course you can count it up if you need to. So you play a random note anywhere, say, okay, what is that? Oh, cool, that one's easy, that's F, because I remember it's right next to E right there, you know? So random notes all over the place. This one's gonna be the same as your low string, and oh, I know from tuning, that's open A, or count it up, whatever you want. So that's one way to do it. A few sessions at that, and you'll start to see some clarity that maybe wasn't there before. The other way to practice it is to, however you can, get something to generate random notes, or look at a lead sheet of a song or songbook or something like that. Songs are great, but they repeat the same notes so often because it's in a key and it's going to have a chord progression that's repeating or something like that. So it just kind of, the first few are kind of fun to find, and then it starts to be a little less challenging, less getting the exercise out of it that we want. So some sort of random note generator, I did a quick search for a random note generator and I found a really cool one, a super clean one. So I found this and I was working with a student of mine and just recommended that they use this, and it worked out really well. And this is on Brett Primintel's website. And I just love how big and clean it is. And you can just hit the space bar and get a new note. And it makes this really easy. Just like, new note, okay, where is that? So, and you, I'm sure there's others out there. That was like the first one I found. I just love how simple, it's not hectic or stressful or anything, just a nice big random note letter, and you can just quiz yourself on finding random notes. Now, of course, where do you want to find that note? Because you could find them anywhere. So I would just map out your octaves of whatever note that is. And you could try to find them. You could even say, I'm going to find stuff on the second string and then do the random note generator and then find everything on a certain string at a time, or you can just find the lowest one and then go up an octave and say, well, it's also there. Go up an octave and say, oh, it's also there. And again, if you just want to use like a lead sheet from a songbook or something like that, that can totally work as well. Okay, so before I get to this bonus tip about when it's actually important to know note names and when it's not, let's do a quick review of everything we just learned. One, we learned the open guitar string notes, the names of those open strings, and we learned the acronym Elephants and Donkeys Grow Big Ears, going from this way to remember those. Two, we learned the natural notes and the structure of natural notes, knowing that B and C and E and F are right next to each other and everything else is a whole step apart. We learned how to remember where those half steps are by the top two strings, E, F, B, C. If you ever forget which ones, it's the first fret and the open strings on the top two strings. We mapped out all the natural notes on the sixth string with that information. We mapped out all the natural notes on the fifth string with that information. Easy enough. We then talked about flat and sharp. Flatting a note is going down, flat tire. Sharping a note is going up, spike sticking up. And then the big one, the thing that we were doing this all for, was that octave shape approach to seeing the fretboard, and that is that we have an octave shape that's two frets up and two strings up off the sixth string and the fifth string, and we have an octave shape that is three frets up and two strings up off the fourth string and the third string. And we talked about how to use that to find any note based on knowing what the note names are off the fifth and sixth string. And then the two ways to practice are play random notes and then figure out what they are with that method, and or get yourself a way to get quizzed on notes with a note generator or a song. Okay, here's this bonus tip. So you got what you need to find any note names all over the guitar. However, in practice, in playing music, it's not always valuable to be thinking of the actual note names of every note all the time. Actually, I think it slows us down. When we want to know the note name is when something is the root. So the root of a key, the root of a scale, the root of a chord, we want to know the note name. We need to know the note name, okay? So like, okay, I'm going to play an E flat chord, and I know that that's E flat. The other notes, I'm not thinking of the note names at all. I'm thinking that this is the fifth of the chord, and this is the third of the chord. And so anything that I might play, if I play like a different kind of chord here, I know the root is C, and I'm actually thinking of the root here, even though I'm not playing it, but the root is over here. Everything else, I'm just thinking, this note is the third of the chord, this note is the seven of the chord, this is the root of the chord, and this is the fifth of the chord. So knowing the root note name is super important, especially, you know, someone's gonna say, hey, this is the chord, we gotta play this chord, or it's written down, or you need to know where to go on the guitar. The rest of it is all intervallic. That's really the way music functions. It's the way it sounds. It's the reason things sound recognizable. It's the reason you can take a song and move it to another key and it sounds like the same song and you can recognize it. So do I know what those other note names are? Sure. Can I find them easily if I don't? Sure, of course. But it's not functionally helpful to be stressing about seeing those and knowing those. So it's so much quicker, so much faster, so much more valuable to be thinking of the actual numbers and number relationships. So if I'm thinking of D major and I'm playing in the scale, right now I'm thinking six. I am not thinking note name. I'm thinking 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1, and I'm very aware that 1 is D because it's the root. The rest of them are all numbers, intervals to me, scale degrees, chord tones, that kind of stuff. And then that allows me to play that way, think that way, hear that way all over the guitar without having to recalibrate every time and say, oh, if I'm thinking F sharp E on D, well, then if next time I'm playing over here in F sharp or in E flat or somewhere else, it's like a whole different language. So that is just a little bit that I wanted to say about that, since we're talking about note names. And that's kind of stuff that I'll talk a lot more about over time on this channel for sure. All right, that's it for this lesson. Do me a favor and write your number one takeaway in the comments below. It really helps us internalize and process things when we write something down. Plus, it helps other people to see what people are writing and learning as well. I hope to see you in another lesson soon, and happy practicing.